When I was a kid, I spent countless Sundays with my father cleaning catfish on the banks of the Arkansas River. We'd bait our hooks with Tyson chicken liver, and we'd listen to Cat Stevens in our Volkswagen van on the way home. A few years later, I watched as my father, a Shiite Muslim Iranian immigrant, converted to Christianity. I grew up in rural Arkansas with a mother from Alabama, but from the time I was 4 years old, I knew I was different. On my first day of kindergarten, I was laughed off the playground when I tried speaking Farsi to my new classmates. I went home, refusing to learn any more of it from my father. My dad came to the U.S. in 1973 to get a degree and had intentions of returning home to Iran. But he met my mom in Alabama and plans changed. The dictator, Ayatollah Khomeini, destroyed Iran's international standing, and my dad watched with sadness as he knew the country that raised him would soon be a place he no longer recognized. Khomeini questioned the voting process, and anyone who didn't align with his vision for the country was labeled a traitor. When extremists stormed the U.S. Capitol on January 6th, I saw a level of violence and insurrection in my own country that paralleled my dad's. The culture and community of rural Arkansas instilled in me love, loyalty, the value of hard work, and a deep connection to the natural world. For these reasons, it's been especially painful to watch lifelong friends and family publicly cheer through their social media accounts as Donald Trump repeatedly enacted policies that harmed my family overseas and spewed rhetoric that stoked the flames of anti-immigrant and anti-Muslim sentiment worldwide.
Total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the United States.
While polarized rhetoric that prevails on the internet would have you believe that there's no place in rural Arkansas for a Farsi-speaking boy who knows how to bait a hook and throw a football, I know better. It is here that I see clearly the fear that permeates this rhetoric, fear amplified by leaders and pundits motivated by self-interest. 40 years ago, my father watched from afar as his native Iran was destroyed by such fear-stoked extremism. I don't want to see my country continue on that path. I feel that the best way to bridge this divide is for individuals to reject the terror-soaked hyperbole and instead look into each other's eyes and listen.